Hi, everybody. It's Pattie with Get Personal with Pattie. And today is a special day. I am going to be interviewing, I have invited all of the candidates running for office in Fairhaven. The election will be held on April 4th, which is a Monday. So if you have any questions about your precinct, where to vote, just really contact the town clerk and they'll be happy to help you. So one cool thing about doing my Get Personal with Pattie show that I've actually have been doing this for now about a year and a half is that because I'm a Fairhaven resident, I have access to the public access channel, which is channel 95. So you can catch most of my, I believe all of my shows either through the FairhavenTV.com website or on YouTube through Fairhaven TV, on Facebook, the Facebook page for Fairhaven TV, as well as Instagram. So I encourage you, if you want to be like a star like I am, or you're interested in a podcast, I mean, the people with, you know, the young men and women that work with the government access channel and public access channel can help you get started. So I'm really excited to do this with the candidates, and I hope you will watch, and I hope you will learn something about each of them, and, you know, help you to decide on who to vote for. Thank you. Hi, it's Pattie again with Get Personal with Pattie, and today's guest is Stacia Powers. Now, Ms. Powers has been on the select board for the last 7 months. She got voted in with the recall election from last year. And so, first of all, we want to thank you for running again. I hope this last 7 months has given you the encouragement to run, I'm assuming?
Yes, it is. It's been great. I really have enjoyed it a lot.
Great. Now, can you tell us a little bit about in the 7 months? I mean, I know it's a learning curve for you as well, getting on, but what one positive thing would you say that's encouraging you to run again?
Well, you know what really encourages me is when people stop me all the time. It's really, it's shocking to me every time somebody would recognize me or stop just to say, hey, thanks.
Wow.
Things
That's
seem
great.
Much better.
Right.
You know, and even if they're not really paying attention, they're still noticing that things are better. And that's what I really am very proud of.
That's good.
You know, we've made some progress on many different issues, but that's the thing that really makes me feel good that, you know, I was able to, you know, help make
yeah.
things better.
Yeah, definitely. It's definitely moving in a positive direction.
Right.
So this is the first year that the Town of Fairhaven Select Board is going from 3 to a 5-person
yes.
seat, which is wonderful. And as we know, there are 6 individuals running for a 3-seat position. Can you tell us a little bit about how the votes will work? If it's going to be a 3, I know we talked a little bit about this, but I don't understand it 100%, so
okay.
I'll ask you. I believe it's by how many votes each person gets that will determine the 3, 2, or 1 year.
Right.
Okay.
So the person that receives the most votes will get the 3-year term.
Okay.
The second person will get 2-year term, and the third person will get the 1-year term.
Okay, great.
So, yeah. Yeah.
And then, you know, we always hope that, you know, like yourself, that the person who does get the 1-year vote, 1-year term, will run again.
Right.
Right, right. I mean,
yes.
you know, hearing a lot about the select board position, would you say that you do get a lot of phone calls from the public addressing any questions and concerns, or
mostly a lot of emails?
Okay.
I think, yeah, people
have
reached out via email, and I try to get back to everyone who sends an email.
Right.
Or somebody will stop, or you know, stop me and ask a question. But yeah, it's been great, and the community has been wonderful and supportive, and I try to get them answers where I can.
Right.
So, yeah, I'm really happy to help wherever I can.
Right. And I only bring that up because I know that sometimes people are intimidated for running in these positions,
mm-hmm.
and sometimes they think, oh, I'm going to get, you know, hundreds of emails a week or a million calls at night.
Well, I do have to say, though, it is a lot of a lot more work than, say, you know, being on the school committee, which was a great position and you have an impact. But there's, you know, being on the select board is a big job.
Right.
There's a lot going on. We every day there's something that that has to be done. So it is a big job.
Right.
There's
Absolutely.
It's a lot more than
you're
than
making
you
a lot
think.
Of decisions for the
a lot of
the
decisions,
community.
A lot of research, a lot of reading, a lot of subcommittee meetings, mm-hmm. and a lot of, you know, conversations offline and trying to move things forward with the with state and even national legislature, trying with, you know, this ARPA money and different funds that are out there. We want to try to get our the most bang for our buck.
Right.
So
great.
We're you know, having conversations with people trying to make those connections and get our projects on list.
Great. Good. Okay, so we'll go right into the questions.
Okay.
So again, I had invited community members to send in questions for the different positions that are running in the town election. So we will start with, what's your opinion on term limits? Should there be term limits for elected positions?
I don't think we're there yet. I think we're getting there. We're getting, and that's another thing I'm pretty proud of. I've seen a huge growth in the number of people signing up for committees that never
Definitely.
Served on a committee before.
Yes.
And I'm so proud of that. I think there, I'm excited by it because it just brings more opinions and more, and they're seeing what their experience is, mm-hmm. and they're like, you know, hey, I like to ride my bike. I'm out on my bike all the time. I want to have a say in this bike path. Mm-hmm. I want to have a say on where my opportunities are to ride my bike.
Right.
And they're jumping on board and being part of things. So I think that is really important. But as far as elected officials go, you said it yourself that it's really, it's you know, people are intimidated. There's a lot of work to do. Mm-hmm. We still have unopposed seats. I said once we can establish many people running for seats, then I think term limit makes sense because then you can have, you open the door for more people.
Right.
I think right now we're not there yet.
Okay, great. And for positions like the town clerk and the tree warden, mm-hmm. that might be a position of maybe more knowledgeable or experienced people. What's your take on should those positions remain elected or do you think appointed?
Yeah, those are really like skilled positions, right? I think I like the idea of them being appointed. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, that those jobs are important to our community. I think we've made, you know, that especially over the last few couple of years, mm-hmm. it's really, especially the trees and the, have really risen to the top. The way technology is moving forward and record keeping is moving forward, we always need a town clerk that will have that kind of knowledge and skills. Mm-hmm. And the way, if it's an elected position, that may not always be the case.
Right.
So I think we're lucky to have who we have now, mm-hmm. and I think she's, you know, I can endorse her because she's running unopposed anyway.
Right.
So
Absolutely.
I think she's wonderful, and I think she's perfect for the job. But that may not always be the case. So I would be in favor of both of those appointed.
Great.
Yeah.
Okay, great. And let's see, the other select board questions. So this question did come in from a viewer, from a community member. I'm not sure the numbers are accurate, so I will read the question as the person asked it.
Okay.
But then I did a little research myself, and so the question was, would you be in favor of the FIOS project, now knowing it'll cost $5,000 per house, possibly costing the town $21 million? Now, that is how the question came in. Now, I did do a little research, and from what I understand, that there has not been a cost asphyxiated with this project as of yet, and it is not Fios. It would be broadband.
Right.
Because Fios is like a Verizon, Verizon.
It's a brand name for Verizon.
Verizon.
Yeah.
So we don't have Verizon in Fairhaven. We have Comcast now. We have broadband. So the town is looking at broadband.
And it would be fiber optic.
Okay, yes.
Which is, and it's faster than your standard cable hookup.
Right.
So the opportunity would be much faster. Speeds for upload and download speeds for our community. I think I'm in favor of anything that saves our residents money and improves their quality of life.
Absolutely.
And this is, and does it in a cost-effective way.
Absolutely.
I think this project is still has to follow many approvals, right? It still has to, there's still a couple of town meeting approvals that it has to pass. Mm-hmm. And they're still getting quotes, they're looking at a pilot, they're still testing the waters. The intention is not to cost the community more money. Mm-hmm. It's to give people another option. Mm-hmm. So no one will be forced into it. It will be in one or the other. You can choose, but it'll give everyone the opportunity to get connected to the internet, which is great. And there's so many other benefits. And you can go to fairhavenconnect.com to learn more about the way this process is working, because that's they really are following a very methodical process.
Yes, great. And just one last question. So considering, you know, why you are running, you know, what one thing would you like to accomplish if you get elected in the next 3, 2, or 1 year?
Well, there's so much we want to conquer. We spent 4.5 hours talking about it a few Saturdays ago.
Oh, I'm sure.
So we have quite the list of goals. I think some of the shorter term goals that I have are to really look at our town committees, look what we're working on, make sure their missions are in line with our goals. And then, you know, make sure that they're working in that process. We don't want people getting on committees and wasting their time sitting talking about the same thing over and over again, or just getting reported out on. Mm-hmm. We want to keep things productive and moving forward. So that would be a big part of it. And also to offer training for people that are serving on boards and committees. If there's more information that they need to better do their job, then the town should be providing that to them.
So I
would like to see that as well. I would also like to, I'd like us to look at our resources and make sure we're properly resourcing the different departments in our town. Mm-hmm. So if people are having a difficulty completing their daily mission of getting their job done because they're short-staffed, maybe we shouldn't this year not put as much away and use some of that to continue to build staff. So I would like us to see us looking at, you know, you don't turn off the lights and the heat to put money in the bank,
right?
So let's just make sure we're giving the departments the appropriate resources, not going and spending money like crazy, but just making sure they have the resources to best serve the community.
So that
would
staff.
Be another goal.
Right.
Yeah, definitely.
Great.
So yeah, those are my.
Yeah, I think it's great goals, and it's certainly, you know, we wish you a lot of luck.
Thank you.
And again, the election is Monday, April 4th. If you have any questions regarding your voting, where to vote, absentee ballots, you can certainly speak to the town clerk over at the Linda Fredette, who's running unopposed. And so, you know, the other thing is something that Stacia said that, you know, I just want to point out is there's always an opportunity to get on a committee in town.
Yes.
So, you know, don't let intimidation stop you in any way. Just, you know, really just reach out. You can always look on the town website.
Yes.
And there's always opportunity to get involved.
And they're all listed. We do put openings on the out in neighborhood news. The missions are clearly stated in the mission of each board is clearly stated in the on the website, and you know, if you have any questions at all, feel free to reach out to me. I'd be happy to help you.
Okay, great. Well, thanks for coming on.
I wish you
a lot of luck.
Thanks for having me.
You're welcome.
Thanks so much.
Hey, everybody. Thanks for coming back. It's Patty, and we now have Leon Corey, who is also up for a seat on the select board. First, we want to say congratulations on, again, taking out papers, and you, ran last year during the...
Recall election. There we go.
Sorry, the recall election, right. So we appreciate that you came back and you're giving it another try, and we wish you the best of luck. So do you want to introduce yourself maybe and tell the voters, you know, a little bit about your campaign?
First of all, thank you for having me. And thank you, Daniel, for being here as well. My name is Leon Corey. I am running for Fairhaven Select Board. Many of you have met me because I've just knocked on your door or rang your doorbell or tripped over your dog or whatever it might be. But, you know, I'll talk more, you know, as we go along. But the reality is what I'm trying to do is just bring Fairhaven back together. You know, as a town, we have an opportunity to really, you know, work with each other and set an example for a country that's really divided. We're a small town and we can be different. We can interact with each other. We can disagree respectfully. We can still be friends while having different political views. And, you know, with that, I also want to bring the town somebody who is actually going to put the entire town in front of them. Not just the people that I'm friends with, not just the people that I agree with, but everybody. And you'll learn that by just the fact that I have been willing to knock on everyone's door. Some of the people at this table and I didn't necessarily always agree, but we do agree on the fact that we want Fairhaven to move forward. We want Fairhaven to be the best Fairhaven that it can be. And therefore, we're able to disagree, still be friendly, and, you know, work together to make the town better.
Great. Thank you very much. So, again, we asked the community for the questions. So the questions that we are asking came from community members, not questions from our heads.
Yep.
Although we have very good questions.
I'm sure you do.
Excellent questions. So first one, five people running, there's three seats up for grabs. Why now?
I ran over the summer, so I don't know that the why now is any different. I felt like we needed a certain change, needed a certain professionalism, and we needed the same things then that we do now, or the same things now that we did then. Nothing has changed. You know, I was on the TA search committee. That has changed. But everything else that was still valid over the summer is valid now. And so I want to do those same things. We're adding two more seats. I don't know that that's necessarily going to make it easier going forward. It's going to provide more views. It's going to provide more opinions. And it can also still, you know, lend itself to the majority versus minority on the board. And so you also need someone who's going to be that balance, who doesn't have, you know, a vested interest from a personal relationship or any history with anybody. And so what I just want to do is, you know, be that person who can speak for everybody, speak for the town, keep my ear to the ground, and also have fresh new ideas for the town so that, you know, the generations behind us that are really going to be most affected by what we do are able to be there.
Okay, great. And for positions like the town clerk and tree warden, that might be a position of knowledge or experience. Do you believe these positions should remain elected?
So I have no issues. I don't necessarily have much to say with respect to town clerk, because I think the past couple town clerks that I've really dealt with have been great as far as I'm concerned. So I don't have anything to say there. With respect to the tree warden, I do think that it being an appointed position will benefit the town. You know, have someone who has the expertise, not somebody who is able to run a campaign. I do believe the current tree warden ran a great campaign, and a lot of us were behind him and said, we'll support whatever. I believe I said I would support him for whatever he ran for after the candidates night, because he just did such a good job of relaying his message and getting the buy-in of the people. But that doesn't necessarily mean that he is the best equipped from a professional standpoint. You know, GB, you know, that their company works with trees. They understand the business. So from a professional standpoint, you know, they actually did have the edge. And so by making it an appointed position, it takes some of that heat off of, we elected you, you have to serve us. And now it's just a job that they have to do, and you can focus on it that way.
Okay, great, thank you.
Yeah, next one, what's your opinion on term limits, and should there be one for the position?
Oh, that is a hotly debated topic on Facebook. You know, some people say that it's not democratic, although the president has a term limit. And so the highest office in the nation has a term limit. I do think that, you know, when you can have a term limit, and I think there does need to be some, because there's a barrier to new people getting involved in the town. There are a lot of things out there, and people want, you know, they want the consistency and the comfort of knowing what you know. And they're potentially afraid of what they don't necessarily know. I was talking to a friend of mine who lives in Florida, and the way they do it in his town is I think you can serve 2-3 year terms, and then you have to take a year off and run again. Mm-hmm. And that allows you to still stay involved in the town, also get a little bit of a break. You know, everyone who serves this town talks about how heavy of an undertaking it is, how much it weighs on them personally, how much it weighs on them from a family life, professional life, whatever it is. This gives you an opportunity to, you know, come back fresh, a better version of yourself, a more energized version of yourself, and maybe even get some new ideas, because now you've just become a regular person in town, not an official the entire time. So I do support them if done correctly.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
So this question came in like this. We're going to change it just slightly, but I'm going to ask it like it came in. So it came in, are you in favor of the FiOS project, now knowing it'll cost $5,000 per household, possibly costing the town $21 million? So I did some research with the Broadband Study Committee, and no figure has come out as of yet on either the $21 million or the $5,000 per household. So, you know, we can, you know, like Cameron actually pointed out with his thing, is that maybe the question came in at, you know, knowing that it may cost the town some money, are you in support of it?
So I think it's a novel idea. I think, you know, as someone who works from home, being able to maximize the speed, the bandwidth that you're getting from your home is incredibly important. As you go down the neck, your cellular signal gets worse and worse. And
yes,
so being, you know, working from, if you're working from home and you're there, you being able to tie into Wi-Fi calling, it would make life so much easier to be able to improve the bandwidth in the town. Also, from a protection and a safety standpoint, you know, some of what we're doing with the town police department and cameras and the fiber optic cameras and such, it would benefit them as well, because they've had to lay some sort of wire in some capacity in order to actually be able to do that and put cameras in various places throughout the town. So I do think the town, it needs to be improved. And if we had vendors, you know, like Comcast or Verizon or whoever who was willing to lay it themselves, then we wouldn't even have this problem. But we are a small town who doesn't necessarily have the massive users that, say, a New Bedford has. We're surrounded by water, and it's not necessarily that easy. Now, to actually answer the question, I support it in theory. But that's without knowing, it wasn't my job to do the research to understand how much it would cost, understand, you know, what kind of burden it would put on the town, also to know what the finances look like from a town standpoint. There are probably other things that might have taken priority, but at least I do support it from an idea standpoint.
We want to thank you for coming on the show, and we congratulate you for taking out papers again, and wish you the best of luck. April 4th, 10 a.m.
Thank you very much.
All right. Hey everybody, it's Pattie again with Get Personal with Pattie, and we now have Cameron Durant, who is running for a seat on the Board of Selectmen.
Yes.
I'm sorry, it's Select Board. Select Board.
It is, yes.
I know.
And that's a good thing.
I know, right, Select Board. Okay, so you want to tell us a little bit about yourself and maybe your campaign?
Sure. Well, my name's Cam, and I've lived in Fairhaven for the past 6 years. My grandmother has lived on West Island since 1957,
yes.
So I summered here, and it's been a great experience moving my family here. I'm an operation manager. I work for a company called GoPuff. It's a company that takes small warehouses and does quick convenience items. So you order it, toothpaste comes to your house in 45 minutes.
Oh.
So it's like operations meet like a tech sector, mm-hmm. Pretty cool. People are my passion. Right now I'm getting my MBA in HR.
Wow.
And so I've enjoyed that. Being a member of the BPW for the past 5 years,
You know, I'm not an engineer, but I thought that I could bring my experiences as a manager. And so a lot of what I've experienced as a member of the BPW is administrative. It's union grievances. It's making that team a cohesive unit. And so that's where I've really enjoyed that people aspect. So I decided, hey, let's go back to school and make that a reality on paper as well. So I'm doing that right now, and that's been a really rewarding experience.
That's great.
The best part of my day is being a husband and a dad to three little girls. We just got back from Florida, so I need a vacation from the vacation.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. I'm sure you do.
Yes.
Hopefully you brought back the sun with you.
Well, it was 85, so let's see what happens in the next few days.
A little bit.
And so that was great. And after two terms on the BPW, I'm interested in becoming a member of the select board. And I think it's because I'm a policy wonk. Like, this is my hobby. Like, I really enjoy going to the BPW, listening to problems, collaborating, coming together. Gets me out of the house, you know? I don't go play flag football. And so this is how I find entertainment. And this is how I, you know, find enjoyment when I'm not at home doing all those things. And so I thought that the select board was a natural step in my journey to learn. Mm-hmm. And it's a wider horizon with more complex issues. And I think that my experiences on BPW and professionally allow me to bring something to the table that I think will benefit the new 5-member board.
Great. I think that's great. Thank you. Yeah. So we'll go right into the questions. And I do like to say that we actually did ask community members for the questions. So we are asking questions from the community. We didn't make up the questions.
Perfect.
Just so everybody knows. And you want to do your best, certainly to speak to us, but certainly to look at the camera as well, because they are your voters.
That's important.
We are too, but, you know, just a little tidbit, right? Yeah, we're only two. So we'll have Danny start first question.
Yep, sure. So 5 running for the seat. Why run now?
Sure. Well, I was excited, and I think I ran a very engaging campaign in the recall election. Prior to that, I didn't run in the previous April election. We had a baby that was 2 months old at the time. Mm. But I saw last July that Fairhaven was in a turning point, and it needed a strong leader who was going to offer collaborative communication. And I put myself out there in order to help bring that change. It was an odd time. It was during the COVID pandemic, so it was tough to have in-person engagement opportunities. Mm-hmm. So we did a lot of social media campaigning, knocking on doors with masks, and while I didn't win, I found it to be such a rewarding experience getting out there and meeting so many people in town that I'm excited to do it again.
And I mean, I always say this at the beginning, thank you for pulling the papers and coming back again. Because some people would feel, again, I keep saying the word intimidated. I know you guys are going to love me with the word intimidation, but it is intimidating. And, you know, just to do a run and not win, but you got some great votes and you had a great team that supported you, it's nice to have you come back again. So, you know, we do appreciate that. The voters do appreciate that.
You know, in last June, July, mm-hmm. I mean, things were rather contentious, and I didn't know what was going to happen putting yourself out there. I was amazed by how positive people were. Right. Like, it was such a rewarding experience, the feedback that I got from everyone.
That's great.
It was great.
Great. Well, we're glad you're back. Yeah. So, second question is, for positions like the town clerk and the tree warden, that might be a position of knowledge or more based on experience, do you believe those positions should remain elected?
Sure. Well, those decisions come down to the residents voting.
Absolutely.
At town meeting. Mm-hmm. And so, obviously, I think that should go to a vote, and whatever the town decides is the appropriate answer. In the last 2-3 years, the town voted to affirm that the town clerk should remain as an elected position, and I have no problem with that.
Right.
As a member of the BPW, and seeing how the different town departments need to coordinate tree efforts, mm-hmm. Removal, I think that it makes sense to make sure that there is a licensed arborist that works for the town full-time, and that the BPW is a greater part of those efforts. Right now, the BPW doesn't have a chainsaw. It doesn't have a bucket truck. Mm-hmm. And so it is very tough right now for the current tree warden, who works very hard with his two part-time staff, to handle all of the volume. Mm-hmm. The current tree warden has done a very good job at bringing to light the needs of that department. I believe that the needs are that the general fund, that the select board, needs to have an arborist full-time, and that should be under the BPW. So that arborist can say, this tree is healthy, and this tree has a chance of surviving, but the BPW can go out there and assist in a storm and what have you to make sure that lanes of egress, that roads are safe to go through. And also, having an arborist will allow us to make sure that we're not just cutting down trees, cutting down trees. That person can say, hey, this would be a great program. We can get this grant to plant this tree. This is the right type of tree. It should go in this location. And so I think that that would be a great balance. But right now, the BPW has the infrastructure to, if there's an emergency, they're going to call the BPW before the tree warden. The BPW is going to be the person. Becky Vento will be the person who gets that call. Mm-hmm. And so it just makes sense operationally. If that was under the select board is only open 8 to 4. There's no necessarily emergency line for that. It's going to go to perhaps the fire department, the police department. Yep. They're going to call the BPW and send someone out to go remove that tree in the road. So it just makes sense that town meeting, in my opinion, vote to have that position go from elected to appointed. Obviously, that would not happen until the current tree warden's term ends.
Expires. Okay, great. Thank you for that.
The next question would be, do you have an opinion on term limits? And should there be term limits for the position?
Sure. I am not a fan of term limits. Again, I think that that is a question for town meeting and the ballot. But I think we limit people's choices when you do that. With that being said, I understand that it does remove a barrier to entry. Incumbency does help in that scenario. And so if the town moved that way in town meeting, I think that that is acceptable. It's fine, but it didn't do that in the past. And I don't know that that would benefit. There's people on the select board now who have been multi-tenured, have a lot of respect in town. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know that Fairhaven would be better if that wasn't allowed to happen.
Yeah. Okay. And so another question that came from the public that came in a little incorrect because I did my own research. And so I will read the question as it came in.
Okay.
And then I will tell you what my research found.
All right.
Okay. So the question came in, would you be in favor of the FiOS project, now knowing it'll cost $5,000 per household, possibly costing the town $21 million? So that's how the question came in. But I did do my own research, and in fact, there has been no cost allotted as of yet, and it's not FiOS, it would be broadband. So I guess we could just turn the question to, what are you in favor of the broadband, the broadband committee looking to start that. It might cost the town some money, it might not, there's grants, et cetera.
Research is never a bad thing.
Right.
If the committee can come back and say X amount of households are interested in this project and they can sustain this moving forward, then that's great. Now, I think what that question is trying to get at is, are you okay with the town borrowing and fronting mm-hmm. that money in order to make sure this happens? And we know that there's a difference between funded debt and unfunded debt. Mm-hmm. So if I went out and I bought fun new homes and cars with $21 million, I didn't have the means to back it up. That's very different than saying, okay, we're going to put liens on the properties and tax liens, right. And we're going to make sure that this is paid off over X amount of years. And if you sell the home, then we're going to make sure that we take that money back. And so I think that this is a great project. My old boss lives in Concord, Mass. And he always talked about how great it was that his internet was $60 a month. Mm. And, you know, this isn't necessarily revolutionary. This isn't the, like, this Fairhaven is
right.
the first,
it's the first
to do
one
this.
To do it. Correct.
So money-wise, I don't think that having the funded debt is a problem. I just question whether there's going to be enough
households
right.
to support
to make it viable.
Okay, great. Well, that is our question for you, Cameron. We appreciate you coming on, and we wish you the best of luck
awesome.
In the upcoming election, April 4th.
Yes, thank you. Appreciate it.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for coming back. This is Pattie with Get Personal with Pattie, and today our guest is Kathy Melanson, who is running for a seat on the Board of Selectmen, Select Board. I know you guys are going to correct me. I'm trying for the Select Board. This is Cristina, our co-host today, and Kathy, you've been around Fairhaven for a very long time.
I have.
And have been on a lot of different boards. So yep. Why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and, you know, why you decided to run on Select Board this year.
Okay. So, as you said, I've been here for a long time, for all my life.
I
a
meant
long
that
time.
Nicely.
Yep. Yep. No. And I didn't say my age, but yes, I've been here all my life. And I try to get very involved in things. I do have a lot of I think I have ADHD because, you know, it's always like I got to do something. Mm-hmm. So when I decided to step in, it was the planning board first. And I kept going until I got in. And then it was like they needed people to be on this board. It's like every time they said they were looking for somebody, Kathy wrote a letter. And it compiled to like 5 boards and commissions. So I'm very dedicated. I love this town, and so many people do. 2 of my daughters are still residents of the town. And between them, they have 7 children, and I have 13 grandchildren. Well, let me correct, 1 on the way to make number 13.
Wow, congratulations.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. So Christmas and things like that are really painful. But I see a lot of different changes in the town. And I want to be part of bringing Fairhaven forward. I have ideas, and I have things I would like to tweak, but this is my town, and I want to keep it a Fairhaven. So I'm going to be a very vocal person, and I am a good listener. So I did listen a lot when I owned my business. There was a lot of people coming in doing mm-hmm. things, but you know what? If I could help them, I did. I think being a select board member, I would be able to do that more often and able to get the answers that they truly need because of being in that position, and I most certainly will. So I'm here to stay.
Great.
I even got a place at Riverside, so I'm really here to stay.
Great.
How's that
one? I have one too.
All right. Maybe we'll be neighbors.
Yeah, really? I know. That's not our age. We're not showing
yes,
our
no,
age.
No. I'm not going anywhere.
Absolutely. So we do have 4 questions that came in from the public.
Okay.
And all select board members were asked the same 4 questions, not in any particular order. But I do want to say just a sidebar quick, because I do try to say this every candidate, is that we do thank you for stepping up and pulling papers.
Well, thank you.
Because sometimes it can be very intimidating to run for any position, elected position in town.
And I can elaborate on that because that's part of things I hear.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes people are a little hesitant.
Yeah.
Because especially if when they're looking at it, they're going to be running against an incumbent
right.
that's been there for many years.
Right.
So they tend to pull back.
Yes.
And I would like to see, I don't want people to be worried about it because even stepping into a position, any one of those positions.
Absolutely.
It still is a learning process. I mean, you've got to come in knowing, you know,
yeah.
something about the
yeah,
town
you can
and
do
everything.
You research very easily.
But you're right. Absolutely right.
Don't
anybody
be
that jumps in, please do so because we have some positions on different committees
right.
that could be filled.
Absolutely. And
so
I
agree
have
with
said
you.
That today, you
yep.
know, with every candidate that we've interviewed
yep.
is that there are many positions opening.
Open, yep.
Usually the select board appoints positions right after the election. So
correct.
If you're interested on getting on.
Get your letter there.
Get your letter in because, and like you started, that's how you started. You
correct.
Started with one position that just you just built it because
yep.
you love Fairhaven. And so we encourage anyone to really get
absolutely.
On board.
Absolutely. And even sometimes if you don't get that the position, you can be put to an alternate.
Yep.
And then when somebody
Absolutely.
Has, yeah, or somebody leaves because of whatever the reason is, mm-hmm. they boost you right up.
Exactly.
I think if more people got involved, they would think and feel that it's not as intimidating or right. scary as it seems.
And actually,
it could be fun, right?
Yeah,
How
absolutely.
Many times have you gotten with people at the end, you know,
yeah,
and became friends? So, yes.
Absolutely.
Let's right. keep
and,
going
and
with
this
that.
Year is there's quite a few people running yeah. for yep. different boards, and that's
and
what
yep.
you know it's that's what we want. It's not a
Absolutely.
Popularity contest.
Nope.
It is not a popularity contest. I will not get on my soapbox.
Yes.
Let's
okay.
get to the
that's
questions.
Not, okay. Cuz we could just go on with that one.
I know,
okay.
right. It's not a popularity contest.
Yes,
if
no.
you're interested, please go ahead and put your name
that's
in.
Right.
That's
it's
what
your town
we need.
Too.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Okay, let's
okay.
get to the questions.
All right.
So, Kathy, now there are 5 people running for the select board and for 3 positions. Why now?
For me, I've been thinking about this for a long time. I have I own businesses. I still own property, so I do a little bit of business management. And being here for the long time and being on different boards and commissions, I see things that can be changed, and I see things that if... Well, when I'm going to be on the mm-hmm. select board, there's more opportunities for me to help out and get things changed and get things moving along. There's people that are afraid to speak up, and we just talked about that. But I have the time. I have the dedication. I'm retired. You call me and you say, you know, there's something going on at the wharf or whatever, doesn't look right. I can jump in my car and swing by and say, oh, that person's right. We need to deal with that. So between... my ambitions, my dedication, my drive, and just my time and my love for the town. It was time now. It's time now.
Great, thank you.
Great. So for positions like town clerk and tree warden that might be a position of knowledge or experience, do you believe these positions should remain elected?
Well, we just had that not too long ago where it was on the town meeting mm-hmm. floor mm-hmm. and they turned it down.
Right.
So I look at it this way, it has to go to town meeting. It's going to be whatever the town meeting voters go for. But we know it's always been this way because it has been. And I don't think it's such a bad thing to keep in a town like this. The tree warden, you know, if the last one, that people said, you know, we're not really happy, whatever, they answered it. Mm-hmm. Every election, they can change their person. I mean, we never had that problem with the town clerk, but, you know, it's something that would have to go through public meetings and see how people really feel. But I think I would leave it in the hands of the town meeting members.
Okay. So, Kathy, what is your opinion on term limits, and should there be one for the select positions?
Okay, term limits, double-edged sword. Mm-hmm. So, in my opinion, every election's a term limit because you have the choice at that moment to remove them. You don't like them, you remove them, vote for somebody else. However, you have people on certain boards and committees that are wealth of knowledge. The only thing is going to that, they tend to lose their focus and their goals because they've been there so long. And it ends up being more of I don't use the word maybe properly, but like an ownership role. And I think that's where people get upset and would like to see term limits. But at this point, and we just discussed this, nobody's stepping up to the plate. So if they don't step up to the plate, what are you going to do? Mm-hmm. And do we want to get rid of all the wealth of knowledge and put somebody in there that's brand new that don't even know a quarter of what they know? So when I say it's a double-edged sword, it's a double-edged sword, no matter how you look at it. There's good, there's bad, and I won't say there's ugly, but there's good and bad. And just like we just did in our, I'm going to bring it up, the tree warden election, you know? They made the term limits, and they elected somebody new. So I would have to say the best way I can answer that question is every election is a term limit, and it's up to the voters of the town.
Great, thank you.
And the last question comes in, are you on the broadband committee now?
I am.
You are, okay, that's a new, recent. Okay, so it is a broadband question. So it's, are you in favor of the broadband project? The question originally came in stating, now knowing that it'll cost $5,000 per household and possibly costing the town $21 million. I personally did my own research on that and was told that the figure has not been set as of yet. I don't know if it's just misinformation or, but because you're on broadband as well, you know, we turn the question to, are you in favor of the broadband project? Why not?
Okay, so transparency.
Absolutely.
I'm on the board.
Okay,
I'm on the
great.
Board of the broadband. But I'm also, I'm for Fairhaven. So the bottom line and the most important thing is I'm here for the Fairhaven residents. So the broadband, and I understand what that question came in and how it came in, okay. being on the committee, and that person's right. It is going to be around that much, okay. and what people have to pay will be around that much. And to find out the correct figures on all that, they are looking at maybe some grants. They are looking at different ways to fund it, but that all depends on how many people want to do it. Now, at this time, there's almost 600 people that answered a survey. Yeah. Well, if that's the only 600 people, yeah, it's going to cost you that much, not more. If more people join in, the more people that join, the less it'll cost per household. So that is why that figure cannot be cut in stone right now, mm-hmm. because we don't know. But also, to answer your first part of the question, whether I'm in favor of it or not, being on the committee, I hear all the positives about it. Of course, you're not going to hear the negatives about it. And since I'm pro-town of Fairhaven and pro-residents, I need to hear the other half. I would like to have some company or somebody with knowledge say the con about it. We know all the pros. I'm sitting there. I know the pros. But I would like to hear the cons about it, because how do you make a decision saying that, you know, we're going to vote on this and the town has to take, and we're just going to use $21 million as a figure. The town's going to borrow $21 million and have the people that got the broadband pay it back in 20 years. And then if somebody sells their house, is there going to be a contract for the buyer that's going to buy the house to finish paying that off? Mm. Those are all, you know, gray areas. And I have to go with putting it all out there, giving everybody the pros and cons, and having the voters make the decision.
Great.
So that was that. I guess I answered it the best I could.
You did.
And
absolutely.
You know, but I just wanted to make sure everybody knew that I am on the committee, so transparency
is
very important.
Absolutely. So that it actually wraps up the questions that we have for you. So
wow.
We just want to say thank you for coming on.
Oh no, I want to thank you. This is pretty nice.
Yes, it's very casual here.
I did very casual.
Yep, blue and yellow.
Blue and yellow, and you know, today we all know what that means. Mm-hmm. So I thought, you know what? I'm just gonna talk to Pattie.
That's right.
And talk to Cristina today.
Absolutely.
So,
Cristina and her husband, because I didn't say this in the beginning, but Cristina and her husband are the administrators for Old Town Fairhaven.
Yes, I see them all the time.
Yes, which is a
it's
wonderful,
an anniversary.
Positive.
Happy anniversary.
Yes, it's a wonderful and positive social media
Absolutely.
Posting. So that's why they're on. I believe it. Yep. I've never met them before now, but they're very positive people, and that's what we need more of in Fairhaven.
Absolutely,
positivity.
And they took it upon themselves to start that.
They did.
And I enjoy it, and I enjoy the little picture things that you got going on for your anniversary.
That's all.
Very nice.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
let me
graphic.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So
thank you
like
for
the,
your feedback, guys.
You know, the animals, the dog.
Oh, yes.
Right, the little
Every
dog
month.
Videos.
Yes.
Yep, you do
Each month he
yeah.
loves doing the videos.
Yeah.
It's
there
creative.
It
He's
is.
Definitely tech savvy with that. I'm just more of like, let's push out the news, let's get out the agendas for the meetings. Mm-hmm. Like,
oh no, let's get some fun stuff in
well.
There. Yes.
But he gets the funny, the humorous side. He's very comical, way
yes.
more than I am. So I'll give him
well,
that.
Well, see,
yeah,
you know,
really
yin and yang.
Yeah.
There
yes.
you go.
Yeah,
so you work together.
We're a pretty good pair.
That's
but
great.
I do appreciate this. And I know we have some other things coming up as candidates.
Mm-hmm.
But I can end with saying that, you know, when I get on the board, people can talk to me and I will handle it.
Okay.
Well, thanks for watching, everybody, and don't forget to vote April 4th.
Thank you.
Thanks. Hey, everybody, it's Pattie with Get Personal with Pattie, and we have our final candidate for tonight, Charlie Murphy, and he is running for a term on the select board. So thank you, Charlie, for being here. We appreciate that you're here. And this my co-host, Dan Lopes. You know, just as a little sidebar, so Danny and his wife run the are the administrators for Old Town Fairhaven on social media, Facebook.
Great.
And they run a very positive page, so we ask everyone to go and, you know, add some positivity to Facebook. So what's going to happen, Charlie, we appreciate you being here. We thank you for taking out papers and, you know, coming back to try to get elected on the select board. We have four questions. All four questions have come from the public. And, you know, there's no particular order that we'll be asking that to you. But why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself and why you're coming back?
Well, I'm Charlie Murphy. I live here in Fairhaven, of course, and have raised all my children here in Fairhaven. And now my granddaughter here in Fairhaven. So I have a lot of love for Fairhaven. Even way back, my grandmother, Mary Cobzo, was the first police matron here in Fairhaven back in the early 1900s. So it's an investment that I've made here in Fairhaven. I have my company, MO Life, started here in Fairhaven. And now we have 65 employees. So we're growing. We had 80, but then we had COVID. So now we have a little bit less. But we love the work we do and just love the town of Fairhaven.
Hey, great. So again, no particular order, and we do have four questions.
Yep, we'll jump right into this. So first one, five people running, there's three seats up for grabs. Why now?
Well, a lot of people ask me that. Why do you want to come back? You know, and I said the answer is simple. That Fairhaven is a great seaside community, and we're starting in a very positive direction and want to continue that positivity. With five members, you know, I think that we can have good representation of the town of Fairhaven. And so now I think is the time for me to come back.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
Thank you. So for positions like the town clerk and tree warden, that might be a position of more knowledge or experience, do you believe these positions should remain elected or versus appointed?
Okay, I believe they should be appointed. And the reason for that is, especially in the town clerk's position, it's very involved. It's incredibly involved. And we're very lucky that we have Linda because she's very knowledgeable. But what if someone else ran against Linda and it became a popularity contest, we could be in some trouble. You know, we could be in trouble with training. The tree warden is also a very skilled, you know, position. I feel that the, you know, the Board of Public Works would have a very good, you know, melding of that position under the Board of Public Works.
You're absolutely right, Charlie. Politics does not have anything to do with popularity. Right? Casual show here. We have another question for you.
Sure. Next one is, do you have any opinions on term limits and should there be for the select board?
So that can go many ways. For term limits, if you had the opportunity to be, you know, on the select board for a certain amount of years and then there was a term limit, then you could take the term limit, take a little break, and then come back. So if there is a term limit, I think that that would have to be something that would go before the town meeting and also maybe to the public for a vote on that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right. Great.
Thank you.
And so this question came in like this, and I'll ask it the way it came in, and then we can just talk about it a little bit. So the question came in, are you in favor of the FiOS project now knowing it'll cost $5,000 per household, possibly costing the town $21 million? So I did a little research, and the dollar amount, either for the town side or the household side, has not been determined as of yet.
Okay.
So, and it's not FiOS, it's broadband, you know, cable. So we're just kind of trying the question, you know, are you in favor of the broadband and, you know, the approaches to get broadband to households, you know, and whether or not it's going to cost the town money, obviously we don't know as of yet.
Mm-hmm.
So just, are you in favor of that?
Well, I'm in favor of having another cable in town. You know, Comcast is a monopoly and it's cost a lot of people a lot of money. But if it's going to cost our citizens, you know, $5,000 per household, that may be something that, you know, that seems very high.
Right.
So, and if it's going to cost the town that much money, you know, what is the benefit for the town and what is the benefit for the citizens? You know, where we already have one cable company and we're already, you know, there's, you know, charges are increasing every year. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to see what the cost would be for per household and what the cost would be to the town of Haven before any final support would go into that. But for a competition and to have other things in town, yes, I think that's a good idea.
Okay, great. I mean, that's really that's our question. We have four questions for you. You did a great job. We thank you for coming. And we, you know, I say this to all the candidates because, you know, it can be very intimidating to run. It can be intimidating to, you know, leave your position and then come back. And we appreciate that you came back and we appreciate that you are running.
Well, I appreciate this opportunity also to speak on there. And thank you for your Facebook page also.
Yes. Oh,
it's a very good Facebook page and really gives a lot of great information.
Yeah, positive. And that's
positive.
That's right.
Positive.
Well, that's my wife.
Yep, absolutely. And we'll be meeting her tomorrow.
Yep.
So we thank you for coming on and we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you very much. Thank you
thank
both
you.
Very much. Thank you.
Hey everybody, it's Pattie with Get Personal Pattie, and we now have Kyle Bueno, who is running for a seat on the school committee.
That's correct, yeah.
And there's two seats open,
yep.
correct?
Two seats open.
Okay, two seats open. So, Kyle, this is your second run at a three-year seat.
Correct.
Correct, okay,
correct.
Great. Yep. So, I mean, if you want to just introduce yourself and a little bit about, you know, why you want to run.
Yeah, well, first I just want to thank both of you for taking the time out of your days to interview a myriad of candidates. And so again, my name is Kyle. I am running for, I can't believe it, a second term on the school committee. It's hard to believe I was a write-in candidate first time, and now, you know, fortunately I'm running unopposed. But I know I'm not taking that for granted, which is why I'm here and why I'm going to a myriad of different events that are in the community. So I'll start with why I wanted to run for school committee. Because I've been an alum of the school system. I've been to Rogers School, East Fairhaven, Hastings, and Fairhaven High. And I served as the, you know, I played the violin in the fourth grade.
I did too.
You did too?
I know.
No
third
way.
Grade. But I'm much older than you.
Oh, please. 25 here.
Twinkle, twinkle, little star.
Really? That was the first song. Yeah, that's the first one. I love that. See, there we go. Nice connection.
Oh, go ahead. Sorry.
No, that's okay. So I did play the violin, and I did track and field and soccer, and I served as class president for the class of 2014, and I served as student rep for the school committee back when I was in 2014, senior year. And so I've always had public service, and literally in my DNA. My parents, both blue-collar workers, my mom works in Toby Hospital, especially during this time. I want to give a huge shout-out to her and so many health care professionals that I had to deal with. Just a whole lot of stuff going on. And especially I want to thank my dad. My dad works at Titleist, and he makes the machine, the golf balls for Titleist. So if anyone golfs, don't ask me for golf balls. Just putting that out there.
Right.
But, you know, he definitely helps a lot of golfers out there. And they're both immigrants. My mom is from Portugal, specifically St. Michael Azores. My dad is from Brazil. And both of them, when they came to this country, they just wanted a better life for their family and also for the community. And and I still remember this at the kitchen table. They said, Kyle, because we were just talking about issues like we normally do. And they're like, if you want to make a change, you have to get involved. And that really sparked the light in me to be like, okay, I want to get involved. I want to really learn how things work, how things function, and just be an asset to the community. If anyone needs anything, I'm that point of contact to direct them to various representatives that can answer any questions or concerns that they may have. So in a nutshell, that's why I decided to run for a second term on school kit.
Great, that's wonderful.
Thank you.
Well, we thank you for being here. And we do have three questions that came in from the public, so we'll go ahead and ask you those questions.
Great.
What are you most proud of in the last few years of being on the school committee, and what are you most looking forward to as far as accomplishments?
I'm just taking
studious,
down notes.
Studious, aren't you?
Because I want to make sure I answer, and I mean this, I want to make sure I answer
the
question. So
we can repeat it at any time, Mr. Bueno.
All right, perfect. That sounds good.
This is a casual show here.
Oh,
We're all among friends.
I know. We're all good people here. So I guess what I'm most proud of would be the K-2 literacy initiative on the school committee. Mm. So we just recently enacted that. And, you know, our early cohort of students reading to the providing reading resources to them, understanding basic vocabulary skills, reading comprehension. It's so profound at that age because there are data that shows that if you are reading literate, like if you're a literate individual, you will thrive. And I don't want to say, you know, just because of that, like you can be anything. And as long as you're kind and compassionate and a hard worker, you can achieve anything. But just the statistics show that if you are literate and you understand reading comprehension, critical thinking skills, you'll thrive in whatever industry that you pursue. And so that was one of the things I was really proud of, because we understand, I guess for myself as an individual, but on the school committee, we understand that we are student focused, and in order to be a successful school district, we need to provide the abundant supports needed for our students to be successful, whether they join the military, whether they join the vocation, or if they go to college. Whatever profession they choose, as long as we have the supports such as the K-2 literacy program, anything's possible. So that was one of my proudest moments on the school committee. In terms of future achievements, or accomplishments, I should say, for the second term, I think what we really need to focus on is social-emotional well-being. But more than that, I think we need to provide more programming or services as much as possible for mental health, also for social health, well-being, because especially during this pandemic, there have been a lot, and I don't have kids, but I know from speaking with other parents and other members of the community, kids have really suffered during this time. And I think if we can be as proactive as possible in providing an inclusive space and providing supports to ensure that students, if they need them, they're there, I think that is a great comfort and something that I will work my tail off to ensure that we can provide those supports and refine the original supports that we already have.
I will say this, because you and I, Kyle and I, have had many discussions when you first ran for school committee.
Yeah.
So everyone knows that my daughter is in the SMEC program, and she actually goes to Old Hammondtown, but she is a Fairhaven student.
Yeah.
So I will say this. So this past week, Monday, if she went to Fairhaven School, she would be an East Fairhaven student.
Mm-hmm.
So with the help of Diane Sullivan at the school board, et cetera, Grace is now attending Monday and Thursdays at East.
Get
right
out of here.
Exactly, at East for the after school new program, new incentive that they just started. They
yeah.
just started like an art club. Every
yeah.
day it's
That's
different.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's like
yeah.
Mondays is the Zoo Mobile Art
they
Club.
Didn't know that.
Yes,
oh.
Tuesday is this, Wednesday. So it's at East. I'm not sure if Wood's doing it as well, but I know East
yeah.
just started. And so I said to them, you know, it's important for Grace to be around her peers. She's a fourth grade student, but she goes out of district. And she is doing Monday and Thursdays at East.
Wow.
And you know how I feel about school committee? I love you guys. I love you guys, but. So,
I think Patty, hopefully she likes me, no?
No, I mean, as a whole, because I always say that because,
No, I get it.
We were in East,
yes.
we were at East, and then we're,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah, anyway. No, I get, well, listen.
And everybody knows, go back and watch all my shows. You can hear exactly how I feel about the school committee.
No, but I think in an honest point, like, your kid is your kid, and you're
right.
going to do whatever you can to advocate for your kid.
Right. Well, you said the word inclusive during
yeah,
that question.
Because I'm very passionate
why,
about that.
Right, and that's
yeah.
why I brought that up. Because,
yeah.
you know, it's in the well-being and the social
yeah.
your accomplishments for the future, because it is important for all our students. It's important for, you know, I know
everybody.
That you guys have children. It's
yeah.
important for our kids to get
Absolutely.
That social. And that's exactly why I wanted Grace to be among her peers, social.
Yeah. yeah.
You know, Diane Sullivan did reach out to me and said, how'd it go? Here's a picture.
Yeah.
And there were like 20 kids in the class. And I said, you know, it went well. It's the first week. But by next week, with her personality and other kids, they'll
She's
recognize
awesome.
Her. And they'll be like, oh, there's Grace. And
yeah.
you know what? And that social, just that's where
yeah.
it starts.
I remember when
when
I was over your house.
Yeah.
And I remember she was just all over, like, you know, just
yeah.
like, hey, how's it going? Like, literally
yeah.
just, and I'm like,
right.
I'm like, I love that.
Well,
I love
that.
That's
because she texts you a lot.
That's what I mean.
Well, I guess you called
That's a whole other story.
Yeah,
oh, so you're part of this too?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm in the club.
Yep,
good.
He's on the club now. All right, let's get back to the question.
Yeah.
I'm glad that you said inclusive and,
yeah.
you know, that one of your accomplishments is social and well-being.
And I want to say, too, you know, like,
kids.
I think on the school committee, like, people, you know, especially with the masks and all that stuff. Like, you know, I'm not, and I say this even during the writing campaign, I'm not perfect. I'm going to make mistakes. There are going to be times that there's going to be disagreements. That's okay. Like, that is how our country and everything's founded. It's just like, let's have a conversation with people. People that even are different, like, as long as we're respectful and we all agree with the common goal of ensuring students are successful and they have the supports that they need, then everything's going to be okay. And that's, you know, that's why I serve, is because I want to be that bridge builder and continue to be with people that don't see eye to eye. Like, it's okay. Like, I'm not offended. No one's offended here. Like, right. We all just want to do what's best.
Dude, that's what social media is for. Everybody agrees, right?
That's
right. There's no disagreement.
There's no disagreements there.
Right, exactly. Right. So we have another one.
Very true. So I hope I answered that.
Oh, yeah, you did a great job. Great job. Yep, absolutely.
Second question. What's your opinion on term limits, and should there be one for the school committee?
Yes, this, I know this question always comes during town meeting and, you know, on Facebook too. So I'm actually against term limits, and the reason why, so I understand it on the federal and state levels because we have career politicians at those levels that receive huge amounts of money, you know, with the recent Citizens United and certain Supreme Court actions that took place. There's a lot of money that's kind of inundated through the state and federal levels. But when it comes to local levels, I think if someone wants to run, they have the right to run. And the general public at the local level also has the power to vote their conscience. Now, you know, fortunately, I mean, not fortunately, but, you know, I'm grateful to be unopposed. But if someone were to run against me, they have the right to do so. And I think those checks and balances, if people want to run, they have to get the signatures, like I would get the signatures from the town clerk, collect the amount of signatures needed, be placed on the ballot if those signatures are certified, and then we move on. So I think on a local basis, I'm against term limits just because I think if anyone wants to run, it's accessible for anyone that wants to run that can run. But on the state and federal level, I think that's kind of a different conversation. I'll be honest, I don't really have a stance on that level, because I kind of do agree with that same mindset for myself, that if anyone wants to run, they have the right to do so. But I also acknowledge the fact that there are certain inequities when it comes to the term limit facet for those upper levels.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the last question is, in recent years, there has been some chatter, about the school committee on transparency. How would you assist your efforts in that role to be a little bit more transparent on school committee in the next 3 years?
Yes, thank you for that. So since I actually ran my writing campaign, I've created a Facebook page for Kyle Bueno-Fairhaven School Committee, and it is pretty active. I actually share agendas on there. I share when our meetings go live, and that to me, so I use Facebook in that regard as solely information-based. If people have comments to send connections, or if they need any questions, I will respond in a reasonable time frame. And then I just want to make sure, because I think, and Dan kind of alluded to this, like social media, you know, sometimes there's so much back and forth, and it just leads to negativity.
Right. And you still don't know the right answer.
And you don't know the right answer. And people get more confused than what they originally were. Mm-hmm. So I think for me, and when it comes to transparency, and again, I can understand their perception, but for me as an individual, because I can't speak for everyone, as an individual, I think one, utilizing Facebook to push information when it comes to sharing the agenda, sharing the meeting when it goes live, and you know, if anyone has any comments, they can email, they can message me directly, and I'll make sure to channel wherever they need that support. I also think, too, you know, Neighborhood News is another outlet that I can definitely, I'll even say for myself, honestly, I think I can definitely utilize more when it comes to, like I've been doing now, like just thanking the voters for giving me the opportunity, again, to run for school committee. And any way that I can be as transparent as possible from Facebook or Neighborhood News, I mean, again, I'm accessible through Facebook. My email is kbueno@fairhavenps.org.
Yes.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you can use those outlets to let me know. Like, you can have a conversation. I'm very, very open. Mm-hmm. I don't like to close doors. Like, I just do what I think is best. Mm-hmm. And if, you know, if people don't think that I'm being transparent or if they don't think that I'm not doing a good job, again, feel free to run.
Right. Constructive criticism.
I love it.
We can all use constructive
criticism.
Oh,
yeah. Absolutely. That's the best. Because if you don't receive constructive criticism, how are you going to grow?
Right. That's
like, I don't have all the answers, but I want people to, and respectfully, message me, right. Talk to me. Like, I'm here. Like, that's the point, because I want to better serve you. If I'm not doing that, and I don't know the answers, then I'm not doing a good job.
Great. Well, that was very nice. It was very nice that you were here and you were able to speak to us today. We really appreciate you coming. We wish you the best of luck in the next 3 years.
Well, thank you too again. And thank you for Haven TV for being
Absolutely.
Here.
And we love for Haven TV.
I think I actually really do appreciate moments like this to be able to continue sharing our message. So thank you very much.
I hope you can come back soon. In the next few weeks, we'll have to get a date together to talk about charter committee.
Oh, boy, I'd love to.
There you go. All right. Thank you very much. Hey, everybody. We're back with Eric Anderson, who is a candidate for school committee. And Eric, you joined school committee last year when Stacia got voted in from the recall. So do you want to tell us a little bit about yourself and, you know, how you came to be? And
yeah, I it was an open seat from Stacia moved up to the select board. It was actually my wife's idea to have me run.
It always is.
Yeah, it always is. Absolutely. It's the person behind the curtain, really. Mm-hmm. And she just, you know, 'cause I always talk about things, you know, the school and so with my kids, obviously. And I wrote a letter and we got the interview with two other people I was against. And I was fortunate enough that I was, I guess you can say, elected mm-hmm. by the school committee and the select board to take Stacia's seat. So I've been there since, I have to go back, probably like late August, early September.
And you loved it, and now you're actually running.
This, which is a whole new world for me. I've never really done anything like this mm-hmm. before, mm-hmm. you know? Again, I do love that political scene, but not like, you know, I know the school committee is not a political scene, but, I put myself out there and I was a little bit nervous if someone's gonna have to run against me, obviously, and how that was gonna look. But, you know, thankfully, sounds like I'm gonna, from what I understand, right. I will have another 3 years to kind of get my game in, mm-hmm. if you would say, yeah. Mm-hmm. yeah.
And so we appreciate that. You know, I always say that, you know, it can be very intimidating to take a seat, even sending in a letter and, you know, you're nervous and right. all that. But then now you're actually running, so we thank you for doing that, because it can be intimidating if other people run against you. You know, I know from experience, because I actually ran a few years ago for select board. I did not get in, but it was close. Not really. You know, we appreciate that you did put your name back on the ballot. So we thank you that you're here.
Yeah.
So we do have three questions that came in from the public. So we, no particular order, we have asked Kyle as well, but, you know, you both are running for unopposed seats.
Yes.
So. We'll just go ahead and get started. Yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
Let's start with this one. Do you have any opinions towards term limits, and should there be term limits for the school committee?
Well, there already is basically if you ran 3 years, you're done. You're
right,
ruining all
right.
that stuff.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, obviously I am brand new and everyone does this, like it's going to their 10th year. Mm-hmm. I'd say I'm not really sure on the school committee. You know, I mean, I do have a more worldly term limit, yes, on other areas when we talk about boards or committees or, you know, regular politics, let's just say. Mm-hmm. But I don't know about the school committee. I mean, I'm brand new. Mm-hmm. So I would say if I'm back here in 3 years at this table again talking with you, I may have an actual different opinion on it.
Great.
But as of right now, I'm probably going to say no. I think, you know, it's we're elected. If somebody doesn't want me after 3 years for whatever reason, I'll be okay with it.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Great.
Yeah.
Great. And in recent years, there's been some chatter about the school committee and their transparency. How would you assist those efforts for yourself to be a little bit more transparent, if needed, to the public?
I mean, one, I think it's going to start with the questions at the meeting itself. You know, if something comes up, if I don't know anything, I'm gonna really kind of take a deep dive into it. Mm-hmm. I know, and you know, I'll throw out there, it is the elephant in the room. Let's just say, like, you know, the sports field was the transparency. I think that's where people are kind of coming from. Mm-hmm. At least that's my educational guess. I would definitely be asking more questions about it. You know, where's money? I mean, it everything should be open. You know, there shouldn't be anything kept in the back and anything secret. There are certain circumstances, don't get me wrong, that I've learned being on the school committee that there is, like, the executive session. But for, like, big ticket items, if you're doing budgets or any type of thing, yeah, I think, you know, just it's asking questions and having people come to me and ask questions. And if I don't know it, I need to go ask, you know, my colleagues that question. And so it's right there. It's in black and white. You can see it on replay or you can see mm-hmm. it in the meetings. I will say this. I've been really kind of pushing forward to getting those minutes out sooner. Because, mm-hmm. I mean, that was one thing that I could not find, were like the minutes, you know, or where people can find them. So that was really difficult in the front. So, I mean, that's like a transparency.
Right, absolutely.
Thing.
Right. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. That's great.
And then the last one, what are you most proud of since you've been on the school committee as far as accomplishments? And is there anything that you're looking at accomplishing moving forward?
I mean, I just started. So I think it's more of just learning the ropes right now. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not, I would say the budget area is not my forte. Mm-hmm. I mean, I even said that during my interview process. That's going to be a learning curve for me, the contracts. But I think the main thing that my focus was is the mental health. You know, I am a licensed mental health counselor. Mm-hmm. I've, you know, been counseling for over 10 years with, you know, but even going further back in residentials and stuff with kids. And I felt like that is the one area that I can definitely bring to the table, you mm-hmm. know, and that's the one area I've kind of been a little bit focusing on while I've been there. You know, mm-hmm. I've been taking that kind of lens, if you will, that, you know, of how can mental health be part of what we're talking about. And, you know, obviously I just last emergency meeting that we had, I did ask to take a look at the bullying policy and just kind of see what's up with that and see if I can revise that and make that a little bit more clearer, because it definitely is, it seems a little bit outdated.
And what is that, what policy?
The bullying policy.
Oh, bullying.
Bullying
yes,
policy,
yes,
excuse
yes.
me.
Oh, yeah.
It's there's some names on there that are, I don't think are longer in the school. It's just updating things.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And then obviously the family center that Superintendent Kohler came up with. I mean, that's something that I really like to kind of move forward and progress and grow. So it's the mental health aspect that I really like to kind of see Fairhaven grow into, that I know it can.
Great. Yeah, that's great. I mean, Kyle really touched up on that as well.
Yeah.
That, you know, because especially coming out of the cold, you know, pandemic and, you know, this week, I think it was this week, that kids could start taking their masks off and, you know, that's opening up, you know, a whole different thing for our children as well. So, well, that's great. It sounds like you've got some pretty sturdy goals to look forward to.
I got one goal at least, and
that'll
be the main one. And
that's
like
okay.
I said, it's, 6 months in, so it's I'm still learning, growing in that position. And I, obviously I hope, you know, people get to know me. I am a bit of an introvert at times, mm-hmm. so... you know, let's just see if where it goes.
And are you available? Do you have an email address? If anybody wants to reach out to you, you're available via email or to talk to you about these things?
Yeah, I have Eric Anderson, Fairhaven School Committee on Facebook.
Okay.
So you can definitely join that. And it's got an email address. Obviously, I am accessible through Fairhaven's own email system.
Yep. So yep.
So that's another way to write to me, which many people did. Obviously, with you know, when we lifted the masks for Fairhaven kids. So those are, and I'm always around. I don't work first shift, so mm-hmm. I'm bringing my kids to school. I'm picking them up. I'm at the school bus. I'm right there. So if anybody wants to. If they recognize his face, then...
Now that you know what he looks like.
You can see me, and I do... Again, I love talking to people, you know, so I definitely like that aspect, which I should, I hopefully, because that's what I do, but I'm very open. So there's multiple ways to find me and get in touch with me.
Right. Well, that's great. Yeah. I think that Well, I think that's all we had for questions. We appreciate you coming on.
Well, thank you.
And we wish you the best of luck in the next 3 years. We hope to see you back in year four, right here.
Yeah, unopposed. Yeah. Great. Again, yeah, we'll keep on going unopposed.
Right, absolutely.
Excellent.
All right, thank you very much. Hey, everybody. It's Pattie with GetPersonalPattie, and we're doing another round of interviewing candidates for the April 4th town election in Fairhaven. And today I have my co-host here, Cristina Lopes. Her and her husband are the administrators for Old Town Fairhaven. It's a Facebook page, and it's a very positive Facebook page, so we ask you to go and check it out and like and comment and be positive. Thank you. So today's first guest is Peter DeTerra. So Peter is on the Board of Health currently and has been for the last 18 years, I believe.
Yes.
And he's running for another term. Yes, time does fly. So Peter, why don't you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about yourself, and then we'll go right into the questions.
All right. Well, thank you, Pattie. Thank you, Cristina Lopes. I'm going to introduce myself. My name is Peter DeTerra. I'm a lifelong resident of Fairhaven. I'm married for 32 years to my wife, Melissa DeTerra. I have four children and three grandchildren. Been on the board 18 years. Let me explain a little bit what the Board of Health does. We're not personal health, we're public health. Personal health, we have our community nurses that take care of a lot of stuff, but public health is more hands-on. I'm a certified food manager, licensed Title V system inspector, Mass Environmental Protection License Soil Evaluator, NIMS 700, Mass Social Health Boards, and numerous licenses that we do every day. So that's mostly what the Board of Health does. It's mostly hands-on and certified board. So,
okay, great. Well, thank you for that little introduction. And Peter, we want to thank you again. As we said to all the people that we've interviewed, is running for office can be certainly intimidating. There's a lot of people running this year, and we appreciate people coming out and actually coming back to continue to run. So we do thank you for that. So we have three questions that came from the public. And no particular order. We have asked the other candidate the same three questions, so we'll go ahead and ask them. Christine, you can go first.
Yeah, sure. Peter, what is your opinion for term limits?
Term limits. Well, technically, in my opinion, we have term limits already. Every 3 years, you come up for re-election for term, and then the public can vote you either in or out. Then you got members of that appointed by selectmen, they are come up every year. Because I'm on zoning board for the last 25 years too. Being on the zoning board, we have 9 members. And being on 9 members, we have 5 full-time members and 4 associates. So if people don't show up when you're appointed to certain boards, we usually check them off as attendances, in attendance. So when they're every 3 years when they come up for an appointment, they either get appointed or not appointed by a selectman. So term limits are good because the town administrator is so busy doing so much stuff that with term limits, you don't want to give too much power to the town administrator. You want to give some to the public too, and they can decide what goes on.
Thank you.
And I certainly agree with you, and we've said this before in earlier segments, but you know, when whether it's an election position, an appointed position, or there's a lot of positions open on mm-hmm. volunteer boards, you know, we encourage people to sign up and
show up.
Like, attendance is so important. We were just talking about this with planning board, mm-hmm. a candidate, yesterday or the day before, that, you know, with planning board and zoning board of appeals, they make decisions based on either 4 or 5 people.
Exactly.
So if one person's absent, it can stretch the meeting and that person, the applicant's time over several months, which really isn't fair. So, you know, I'm glad you mentioned that.
On zoning board, we meet once a month. I've been there 25 years. I was there on the zoning board before I was elected.
Mm-hmm.
So I learned a lot to move on to be elected. But I have 9 members, and I can barely get 5 members. People don't show up. And the applicant's sitting in, it's like,
right.
We got certain people that has never came in town hall, asked for one thing. We're here to help the people and work with the people.
Right.
That's our goal here.
Right. So Peter's saying that if you're interested in zoning board, you know, send in a letter, because there are appointments that come up every year, especially right after elections,
exactly.
when the select board makes those appointments. So if you're interested in any, you know, zoning board or any of the boards, certainly send your letters in. And commitment is important. Okay.
Okay.
So I'll go to my question here. So Peter, it's no secret that the Board of Health hasn't been very transparent in the last 2 years. How would you change that and be more transparent to the public?
Transparent on which way?
Well, transparent. Just this was a question that came in from the public. So, you know, the question was somebody doesn't feel that Board of Health has been transparent in the last couple of years. So,
well,
transparent meaning, you know, how would you make sure that everything that happens at a Board of Health meeting is public information and gets to people so they don't feel that they're missing something?
Oh, I understand what you're trying to say.
Okay, sure.
Yes, being on the board for 18 years. Years ago, it used to be just your office. Now with public access, it's come a long ways. You're open every meeting, you open stuff. I put my name on the list, so if you want to call me, I put my number. I've been asking Vicki I feel every board member should have an email at the end for you to contact the board members. They are working on that. They say it costs so much money. I feel not just elected officials, but appointed officials should have email if you can contact. That's one way. And when being elected official be contact, you should have more outreach. We've been doing more PSAs. So when there's a, like the flu pandemic or something, we have Dave coming every week and doing on Facebook. We're doing all the PSAs now. And with the flu pandemic, we've been putting signs up and educating people. So education, more outreach, and more emails, and more for the people who can be one-on-one email or contact you. Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay. And the last question is, what is your opinion on showing your vaccination card or having mask mandates in town? This is a hot topic.
That has been a hot topic. It's been a hot topic at the Board of Health. I mean, the flu pandemic was a very awful sight. It blindsided us. I mean, we worked when the mask mandate worked. We worked with the governor when he had the mask mandate. We worked hand in hand with the governor. They set up hotlines, they set up stuff to control the mask. Once the governor dropped the mask mandate, some people wanted it, some people don't. I felt that education was the key. So we talked about it at meetings. We went to all the restaurants in Fairhaven, all the regular things. We started putting up signs. I got some signs here. That either we put different signs up saying, for masks, if you want a mask or don't want a mask, but we highly recommend a mask. And we kind of left it more on the burden of the businesses than on about some people can't have a mask. Immune deficiencies, but some can. But I felt that it's more education is the key for a mask mandate and the work with the people. And I feel everybody doesn't have a mask, so education, working with the people, working with the restaurants, working with the board is the key right here.
Great,
right,
thank you.
Great, thank you. And that is it. That was our three questions.
Oh,
it was easy. Easy, Peter.
thank you for being on, and we appreciate it.
Wish you the best of luck in the upcoming election.
Thank you for inviting me.
All right, thank you. Hey, everybody, it's Pattie with Get Personal with Pattie, and our first guest today is Heidi Hacking, a new member to the political scene, and she is running for Board of Health. Heidi, you want to tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. So I've been a lifelong resident of Fairhaven. I have 30 years plus years of experience as an RN. I've worked in acute care, chronic care. I've worked at a psychiatric nursing home, long-term care. So I have a very wide background in healthcare. I now work in hospital administration. I've worked in quality improvement, and now I'm in risk management. So that's a little bit about my background. I'm also, as I said, I've lived all my life in Fairhaven at the same address. And I like to do a lot of activities in Fairhaven. It's my home. It's where I work. It's where I play. And so that's a little bit about who I am and why I'm running.
Great. We appreciate that. First, so I did forget to say this. My first thought is thank you for, you know, running and being from experience for someone who has run in the past. I know it's a lot of work and it could be very intimidating, but it's nice to see that more people are running every year. So congratulations on that. So we're just gonna get started. We have three questions. We did ask people from the community to send questions in, and those are the questions that we're asking.
Yeah, so one of the questions that we had here was, do you have any opinions on any term limits?
Term limits, that's interesting, because I hadn't really thought of that in my role. This is my first time running, and I don't really have a political background, but I am for term limits. I believe that they should be. As someone, I've served as past president of the Cultural Council, and there is a term limit on that. You can only serve for 7 years. I've also been president of the Buzzards Bay Rowing Club. We have no term limits. There should be a term limit. Your effectiveness sometimes decreases. You get into a comfort zone. So yeah, I do. I think that term limits are appropriate, and I would support that.
Great. Thank you.
Yeah.
Our second question is, so it's no secret that the Board of Health hasn't been very transparent in the last few years. So we would like to know, the community would like to know, how do you foresee yourself changing that, and how are you going to hopefully be more transparent to the community?
Sure. So in my current role as a risk manager for St. Luke's, we are very transparent in all our interactions. We have to be. You owe it to your customers to do that. Should something arise, we have reports that we file to the Department of Public Health. And not only do they go to the Department of Public Health, they go to the patient's insurance, they also go out to the patient. At the end of it, after our investigation, the patient actually gets a copy of what our investigation shows, what happened. So transparency is something I'm very familiar with. I believe in full disclosure of whatever happens. How am I going to bring that to the Board of Health? I think one way is, I mean, we are televised. You can't hide too much from that. So that's something interesting and new for me, to be actually on the record all the time. Mm-hmm. So that's good. But I also think you have to be visible. I think you have to be out there. I think you have to meet the people. You have to be able to answer questions. You have to have that comfort level and confidence to know that you're going to lead by example, that you're going to try to do the right things. You may not always agree with everyone. But at the same time, you need to be respectful. You need to know that in your disagreements, that there are good points and bad points to everyone's point of view. And you need to incorporate that into what you're telling people. So transparency is not a tricky thing. It's just being open and honest, and showing people that we have the best intent on what we do. So I think that transparency, you get more done. What are you trying to hide?
Right.
So I think that that's important, that you bring forward that transparency. Again, we're televised. I'm not sure how the Board of Health hasn't been transparent in the past, but if that's something that the public feels not happening, then I would look into that and definitely see what actions we could take to rectify it.
Great. Thank you. And we have one more for you.
Yep, I think one of the last things, and this has come up the past couple of years here, but do you have any opinions on vaccination mandates or mask mandates in the town?
Sure. So I am from a healthcare background, and I believe in science. Won't get me any votes from some people, I know. But it is what I believe in. You will see that vaccines do work. I mean, we can reach back into history to see what vaccines do. I recently said, if you forget the polio epidemic, you're not going to be prepared for your next epidemic, right? So we vaccine for polio, we vaccine for smallpox, we vaccine for those things, and we help people, and it was a good thing to do. So yes, I would agree with vaccines, and I agree with the mask mandate to a point. So, and when I say that, I say, I think you have to look at numbers. You have to look at events. You have to look at the situation. So to say a carte blank, everyone should wear masks all the time, no. But you need to set up metrics, right? So we have COVID, and the numbers are astronomical, and these are areas that you might be at risk for. You can't maintain social distancing. You can't, you're not vaccinated. Maybe in those situations, you should wear a mask. Personally, I don't even like to get a cold. So, I mean, I would wear a mask just to protect myself in a lot of situations. I also live with two elderly people who are at high risk. I would wear a mask to protect them. So masks do more than just protecting me. It may protect those I love around me. So I think that it's important to not take things out of context, but to remember why we're wearing a mask, who it's protecting, who it's for, and do it at the right times.
Great. Well, thank you very much for your answers.
Thank you.
We appreciate you being here. Is there any last words that you want to say about anything?
No, I'm having a meet and greet on, if people want to come out and talk more about these questions, on the March 13th. And they can go online and purchase tickets. It's going, or they can show up and purchase tickets at the door. It's at 42 Main Street, and we'll have soups and sandwiches, soups and sweets, and some live music. And I really want to talk to people, is what I want to do. Right. I want to hear what's bothering people and what they want.
Great. Well, thank you for being so transparent. And we thank you for being on the show,
no
and
problem.
We wish you a lot of luck.
Thanks for
thank
inviting me.
Thank you very
me.
Much.
I appreciate it.
Oh, you're welcome. Yeah. Hi everybody, it's Pattie with Get Personal with Pattie, and my first guest is Ann Morton-Smith.
Correct.
And she is a Fairhaven resident, and she's going to tell us a little bit about herself, but she is running for a seat on the Department of Public Works Board. So why don't you start by just telling us like who you are, how long you've been in Fairhaven, I don't know
sure.
if you're a lifelong resident.
Okay. My name is Ann Morton-Smith. I've lived in Fairhaven for 12 years now, I think. I actually grew up across the bridge, and when I decided to come back to the South Coast, I chose Fairhaven with my husband.
Great, great. Wonderful. And so why now do you want to run for a seat on the DPW?
I have gotten really interested in what's happening in Fairhaven over the past couple of years, mm-hmm. and I like to be part of what makes it tick.
Great.
And as far as the Board of Public Works goes, I feel like I have taken it for granted. And without it, we really don't have a foundation for anything. And without water, sewer, roads, beaches, parks, right. trees, all of these great things, I'm not sure that we really appreciate all the work that goes into making it such a great place to live.
Yep, that's great. I mean, certainly it would be nice to see a woman on the DPW board as well. That's my opinion, you know, because it's been mostly, I think, in Fairhaven male-dominated boards. So it's certainly nice to see a woman, you know, run in a couple of different positions this year
sure.
for the election. So my other question is, there's a lot of talk around the tree warden being an elected mm. or appointed position right now in Fairhaven.
Sure.
So what's your take on that? Should
My take on that is that it's not working very well the way it is.
Right.
And I think it's really important that we figure that out. And I think we can figure that out. I think we've got a lot of smart people around the table, on both sides of the table.
Right.
And we should and can make that work a lot better. You know, there are a lot of things that make life in Fairhaven wonderful. One of them is trees.
Right, absolutely.
The trees have been here for a long time, and a lot has changed in their lifetime, and there are a lot of competing interests that I think we all have to take into account when it comes to preserving our tree canopy and our shade experience. You know, there's right. sidewalks and roads and, you know, people with disabilities, and there's a lot we have to pay attention to. So I'm really looking forward to being part of that solution.
Great. That's great. That's definitely something that's, you know, everyone's talking about. So
yeah.
it's certainly something I'm sure in the next year it's going to be hopefully resolved.
Whether oh,
it's
I hope
one way
so.
Or the other.
Yeah.
It'll go to town meeting.
Sure.
Obviously, it'll go to town meeting really has the final word on, mm-hmm. you know, a lot of these suggestions that the boards, you know, put forth. So the other question is, and I did ask a few people from the community to write in questions. So a couple of these are from, you know, our community members. So the DPW, I believe one of the things that they're looking at as well is to relocate the recycling center because of the, you know, they have to do the new wastewater treatment as well.
Sure.
So do you have any suggestions in Fairhaven where you'd like to see it, where it might be? I mean, I know, you know, Fairhaven as a whole, we don't have a lot of open space left. And, you know, so, you know, any idea where you'd like to see it or where you'd like to suggest?
Well, I believe there is a proposed location,
okay.
Which is off of Bridge Street, where the old landfill yes. is, which to me makes a lot of sense. I've been reading up on it, but I don't necessarily know everything there is to know about that, that's for sure.
Yep,
but it seems like a great location, a great reuse of that property for a similar use.
Right.
Makes sense.
Okay, great. And there's just one more question. If you do get elected, what one thing would you like to take on, if you have one thing that you'd like to see happen in your tenure as an elected official on the DPW? Is there anything?
Oh, that's a tough one.
I know.
there's so many things that already work really well in our town. I think that there are ways to make a lot of things better. Unfortunately, they all take funding. And there are a lot of things that it seems like it would be really easy to do, like, get recycling bins at the beach, to get restrooms near the bike path. There's all kinds of things like that. I think I would just feel really good if we felt good about, what's probably most important to me is following through on the plans that are in place now. And watching it evolve.
Great. Well, I want to thank Anne for coming on today. And this is the first time I'm meeting her. So I wish you a lot
nice
of luck.
Nice to meet you, Pattie.
And
thank you.
April 4th, Monday.
I look forward to it. And please do give me your vote.
Right. And we thank you for actually, putting forth. I thank everyone who goes out and, really gets out of your comfort zone to run for any position in town. Because it can be intimidating. So I know from experience, but...
I'm excited about it. I work with committees for a living.
Oh, good. Great. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank
you.
Thank you.
Hey, everybody. We're back. This is Pattie with Get Personal with Pattie, and we have Kevin Grant here with us today. He is a candidate for the planning board at the local election in Fairhaven on April 4th. So first of all, thank you, Kevin, for coming out and meeting us today.
Thank
you.
This
is Cristina, my co-host. And Cristina and her husband are moderators on a social media Facebook page called Old Town Fairhaven.
Excellent.
And it's very positive. And I have not met them until yesterday and today, personally. And the reason why I chose them to be co-hosts is because they started a positive page on social media. So
that's not an easy thing to do.
It is not.
Right.
And they've kept it up, mm-hmm. So it's a really a nice group. So if you have a chance to go check it out, you should do that. So tell us a little bit about yourself and, what made you run for this planning board seat?
Sure. My name is Kevin Grant. I was born in Fall River. I'm not from Fairhaven. My wife was born and raised in Fairhaven. We lived in New Bedford for quite a few years and just bought a house 3 years ago in Fairhaven. Wanted to raise our son here to be closer to my in-laws too. And we bought a real fixer-upper and it's been an adjustment for me. I always lived in cities. I didn't think I'd ever want to live in a small town. And instantly I was like, what have I been missing out on? This is great. So I love it here. We always were thinking like, once we're here for a little while, maybe we would want to get involved in the community or in politics. And at the same time, it's kind of like not, had mixed feelings about that a little bit. And then I saw Wayne Hayward's post that there were two openings on the board that no one had pulled papers for. And he made it clear in the post that that could be really detrimental to the town if those seats weren't filled. So I was actually on vacation with my wife when I saw that. And I'm like, all right.
I think this now, is a sign.
Yeah, is this the thing I was waiting to read?
Mm-hmm.
So I talked to my wife about it. I messaged Wayne. He let me know a little bit about it. So I started the process. And since then, two additional people have filed papers for the two seats. So there's one extra person in the mix, which makes it a little more exciting than I thought it was going to be. but I'm someone that, I feel that it's if you can contribute something and you're not, you don't think the world is perfect and nothing is perfect and you have a chance to contribute, that beats just complaining about it at home.
Right, absolutely.
So I feel like I I could help. I do want to serve the town. A little bit more about me is that I worked in the food industry for most of my life, and for the past few years I've been the senior planner for a company out of California called Revolution Foods. We do natural food programs for primarily school systems, but then when the coronavirus hit, we started doing a lot of emergency food distribution. So we've served roughly 100 million meals since the pandemic started. And a lot of that was figuring out, like, okay, this is not what we do as a company, but this is what has fallen into our lap, and how can we make this work, and how can we plan ahead? And so although the title is the same, a planner, mm-hmm. and it's vastly, vastly different, it does require a skill set of being able to think of the future and not lose yourself in details, and be sort of, look at the whole thing as an organization and not a bunch of separate facets. And you need everything to sort of work together copacetically and be in it for the long haul, not just for an immediate benefit that is going to really hurt you down the road.
Oh, great. I mean, that's a great introduction. I've said it before on my show, and especially this week with interviewing different candidates, and we thank you for taking out papers and making that step, because, you know, running for any office is really, can be intimidating, and, you know, so you pull papers, and then, you know, two others pull papers, but, you know, it's certainly a commitment, and if no one did pull papers, then, you know, it could be detrimental, because planning along with other boards make decisions for developers and mm-hmm. the planning of Fairhaven. So, you know, we're glad that you stepped up to that. Absolutely. So, Cristina?
So, Kevin, at the end of your four-year term, what do you hope to have accomplished?
Well, I hope to be, you know, obviously this isn't a one-person game, so I hope to be an effective team player with the group that's there. I want to learn as I go. Obviously, I'm pretty green with this. I've had exactly 0 minutes on the job, but I'm hoping to learn quickly, learn on my feet, and at the same time, you know, I have my own feelings about, you know, the town and what I think the potential of the town could be. They might not be everybody's feelings. So, you know, I think when we have a democracy and we have teams of people that work together to get things done, what you hope to do is pull things towards the center and towards the middle. So if I can contribute by helping pull things a little bit towards where I think the town could go, that's really the best you can hope for. And, you know, when you don't get everything that you want, that's a sign that your democracy is working, because that's what it is, you know. So you try to draw things into where you think is a better direction, knowing that you're just going to get partway there, but maybe you'll have a positive impact overall.
Great, thank you. So there's, you know, the next question is, you know, more so like, have you become familiar with the planning board's tab on the Fairhaven website? And our planning director has received many grants in the last year or two for different improvements in town. Complete streets, a Union Wharf study, Route 6 and 240 redevelopment study, and then most recently a community planning grant, which is to write a 40R bylaw and design standards. So, I mean, looking at the grants that have come in, do you have any opinion on any that stand out maybe more important than others? I mean, they're all important.
They are all important, and there's a lot on the table for sure. One of the ones that I think is really important is the Route 240 and Route 6 work, because a lot of that work was done at a time in our country's history where they had radically different views upon infrastructure, the highway system, what it should be, you know, whether it was running 195 right through the middle of Fall River and right through the middle of New Bedford, and 140, you know, through Fall River, and 24 through Fall River, and 18 through New Bedford. And, you know, this did damage that can never be undone. But what can be done is to look at it now, hindsight being 2020, and say, all right, you know, we can't put the genie back in the bottle, but what can we do with what's been done to make it better, knowing now what we know about, you know, how a community needs to work, and the natural flow of people in and out of neighborhoods and things like that. I know there's a ton of infrastructure development, not just on the table for Fairhaven, but you know, New Bedford with the commuter rail, really across the country, there's a lot of funding for that right now. So I think that's exciting because it's something that you can't really do over. Mm-hmm. You know, you get one chance to get it right. It's a big expenditure, but it's a great opportunity. And I think that a lot of what has historically gone on along Route 6 in Fairhaven, our mentality as a culture has also changed about that as well, and our needs as far as the economy goes. You know, a lot of what's on Route 6 and even headed that way down 240, it's just these large expanses of parking lots for brick and mortar buildings that our society doesn't shop in anymore. And they're having a hard time finding tenants. Whereas at the time it was like, this is great. It's gonna bring in so much tax money. So many people are gonna shop here and it's gonna provide a lot of jobs. The result of it is though, is that we still haven't seen the end of people abandoning brick and mortar stores because the older generations are still doing that. They're not shopping online, but they're not gonna be here forever. There's fewer and fewer of them. So those store closings are gonna continue. And, you know, when I look at these plazas, I think, all right, here's a plaza owned by a company that's out of state. And here's a giant chain store that's headquartered way out of state. Mm-hmm. And they're paying a handful of local people pretty low incomes. So our community's shopping there, and that money goes to the business headquartered in Tennessee and the landlord headquartered in New York State. And they give as little possible back to the people who work here. And it's our money as shoppers that's going there and going out. It doesn't stay. So, you know, as they look at, like, you know, when you start talking about, like, how can we reconfigure these highways and stuff like that, what's along those highways can also be affected, positively or negatively. And I think that the only sort of future for brick and mortar stores are shopping locally, buying locally, stores that use local vendors, food industry places that use our local farms, use seasonal and local ingredients. So I know this started out as a talk like, what do you think about, you know, this road work? Well, you know, the roads are just as good as what's on the side of them. And I feel like a lot of what was done in the past would never happen now. But we're stuck again, like, you can only deal with the hands you've been dealt. So what do? We have acres and acres of parking lots and lots of vacant storefronts, and we need to think about how we're going to go forward with that. Do we continue to bring in, you know, Walmarts and Burger Kings and McDonald's, or do we try to invest in local entrepreneurs and somehow use those spaces that way?
Great. That was a great answer. Thank you.
Great. Kevin, what's your opinion on term limits?
That's, in general, I don't necessarily believe in term limits. I think that elections are your term limit, and that if someone's doing a great job, just because a stopwatch has run out on them is not a good reason to get them out of that position. And they have a pretty serious job evaluation every time that election comes up. So that's a chance for people to say, this guy or girl their time has run out. I mean, they've done enough. It was good while it lasted, time for somebody new. So every, you know, elected position has a shelf life, but there's an opportunity to extend that if you think they're doing a great job. And, you know, I've seen many examples in my life of people who did wonderful work for 2, 3, 4 decades in politics. And had there been a term limit, some of their best work never would have been done. And there's also such a thing, you know, to be said for experience. You know, I certainly learn stuff at my job every single day, and I probably wasn't the best at it during the first 2 years or 4 years. You know, I tend to turn to the oldest people I know in my field to ask advice, and there's a reason for that.
All the questions we had, so we thank you for coming on the show.
Okay.
And we wish you the best of luck.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Hey everybody, it's Pattie and I'm back with another guest, and it's Andrew Romano.
Hi.
Hi, welcome, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
My co-host Danny, and I just want to say, first of all, thank you for taking out papers and, you know, getting into the race this year. This is your first time running.
First time ever for anything,
Yep, and it's very, it can be an intimidating situation, but we do always encourage people to run and come out and vote. So Andrew is running for a seat on the planning board.
Yep.
Great. And do you want to tell us a little bit about yourself and perhaps why you decided to run?
Yeah, sure. So I'm a lifelong Fairhaven resident. I currently live here with my fiance, our rescue animals. We have two dogs and a couple of cats. And I've always worked in town. I have all my friends are in town. And pretty much I just feel like every year election season rolls around and somebody tells me, you know, hey, you'd be great at this. And I'm like, okay, yeah, I'll think about it. And, you know, I've never really found anything that I felt was really for me. And then I feel like a lot of people during COVID, I started paying a lot more attention and watching more town meetings and trying to get more involved. And I mean, I really had nothing else to do but sit home and watch my TV like everyone else.
And you chose to watch channel 18?
You know, there was a lot of time at home. but I also, around that time, started getting into real estate, and I was working both at the same time, and I had a friend who's on the planning board, Jessica Fidalgo, reach out to me and say, you know, hey, this upcoming election, there's going to be two vacant seats, nobody's filled papers, I think you'd be great at this. And I said, you know, I can win against nobody, I'll try. So I pulled, thinking I had a good shot. And then two more people pulled papers, and I wasn't really anticipating a campaign, to say the least. I thought it was going to be one of those, oh, pull the papers, see what happens. But I'm excited to, you know, get my name out there and see what happens.
Absolutely. I think that's great.
Yeah, that's awesome. If you were to say at the end of your term, is there any areas in the town planning that you'd hope to have addressed?
So one of the biggest things that I kind of, at first when I pulled and there was no one running against me and it was just a done deal, I thought this is a great opportunity for me to get on, learn more about planning board, further my career and learn about maybe some areas I know about, and then also bring a unique perspective to, you know, what might be missing on the planning board. You know, what are they not seeing from a real estate standpoint? And then once I, you know, really started paying more attention and I wanted to make sure I had the right answers for things, I don't think that there is really anything that I'm unhappy with that the planning board is currently doing. I'm not running to be that guy to say, I'm gonna go in here and fix this, because they're very educated. They're doing a very great job. And I think that there are rules that everyone needs to follow when they're looking for developments or, you know, to bring a business in town. And I wanna be able to say at the end of my 4 years that I was able to help keep Fairhaven a town that people wanna relocate to. I've spoken on it that working in my career, I get a lot of people who are excited, and they always tell me every time I talk to my clients, Fairhaven is usually at the top of their list. Where do you want to move? I want to be in Fairhaven. Mm-hmm. And I guess my goal is in 4 years to look back, and when I still have a meeting with a new buyer, still hear them say, I want to be in Fairhaven. Great. This is where I want to live.
That's great. Thank you. Being that your profession is real estate, do you anticipate or have you had a phone call with the Ethics Commission beforehand to separate land transactions from town permitting?
I have not, but I will.
Okay, good.
I don't have a long answer.
Yeah, no, that's okay. That's okay.
I know I need to, and it's funny because I've there's a few different developments that I speak a lot with Jess, and a lot of times I say to her, I'm like, now is that a conflict of interest?
What?
And I know, is that a conflict of interest? Like, you know, I might have a buyer for that. Is that a conflict of interest? So I definitely think there's going to be a strong learning curve at first, but I'm a quick learner.
Right.
And, you know, I am, yeah, I'll know when it's an appropriate time for me to remove myself and when there's an area that maybe I know I'm not super involved in that I can really give, you know, my opinion and knowledge on.
Right. And that, you know, that brings up a good point, that it's, you know, whether it's a conflict of interest or not, and you get that heads up from Ethics Commission, you can email them, you can call them, and they get right back to you, and then you just recuse yourself.
Exactly.
You know, so, you know, we don't want anyone I say this all the time, I've said this on my show as well, like, it can be intimidating to run, and then if you think, like, okay, I don't want to run because I might have a conflict, and, you know, mm-hmm. you know, everyone's welcome to run, and everyone's welcome to, you know, get on a lot of the boards, and even the volunteer, be a volunteer on a board. Right. So, you know,
and my kudos to you. My kind of thought process behind that was, I figured, and like you just said, I feel like the projects that are not going to be a conflict of interest mm-hmm. to me are far going to outweigh the few that may right. be a concern. I don't work with a lot of developers. I mostly work with people who are looking to relocate, so I know that, you know, right. I'm going to quickly learn where
right.
my line
exactly.
is.
Great, yep. great. And we just have one more for you. Right. So right now, the planning, I don't know if you're familiar with the planning board's mm-hmm. Website. You know, there's a lot of information on their website right now, and the town planner, Paul Foley, has gotten received quite a bit of grants this year, in the last couple years, actually. He's gotten, let's see, the Complete Streets Grant, a Union Wharf Studies happening right now, Route 6 and 240 Redevelopment Studies happening. Mm-hmm. There's a Community Planning Grant. That is to write a 40R bylaw and design standards. So the question was, are you familiar with the Planning Board website and these grants? And yes or no? And then if you are any of the grants that you read about, or maybe that I've stated, feel more important one versus the other?
Yeah, so I've actually spent a lot of time on the Planning Board website the past month. I agree that there is a lot of information out there, and I think it can definitely feel overwhelming at first trying to categorize, you know, what is the most important and what is the least important. And coming around that, I don't really think there is a fully fair answer to that, because every single one of those things is the most important to the person, you know, to who is trying to get that accomplished. For me personally, and I guess I don't want to use the word that I've been ignorant for a while, I can't personally rank or categorize any of them quite just yet, because I am still in such a learning period, reading about all mm-hmm. of them. Mm-hmm. And I hope that's
No, that's honest.
One thing about me, and I'm not afraid to say that, I know when I can say I'm not educated enough about something to speak on it, and that's why I want to continue reading more, continue seeing what the biggest issues to the voters mm-hmm. are and to the people who don't vote but should vote.
Right, absolutely.
on April 4th in every other election.
Right, absolutely.
I think that was right.
That I was mean, good. just the fact that you said you've been on the website, and
right.
it is. Paul has.
Day one, I went home, I pulled papers, I went on the website, and went Planning Board mission statement, and I
right.
kept
right.
reading it.
Exactly.
Said, Planning Board bylaws, zoning bylaws.
Right.
You know,
exactly.
Make sure I'm.
Yeah, there's definitely a lot of information there, but no,
right.
I think that was a great.
And also,
great
too,
answer.
Another thing that I've been trying to do is prioritize. Because when I pulled the papers, it was almost January, so I've been really trying to look and say, okay, what's going to be resolved by the time I get there?
Right.
What's going to be, you know, more of a long-term project? Where should I put my energy and learning about first?
Right.
So it's really, you know,
right.
been trying to weigh it all out right. and make sure I'm not missing anything.
You know, and I will say, one of the important things for all the boards in town, and, you know, even the volunteer boards, is the commitment. Mm. Because, you know, some people might, you know, get on and, you know, they're absent two or three meetings. Like, so for a planning board, and there's other boards that actually have to take votes that so many people have to be present mm. for the special permit to pass, et cetera. So it's, you know, it's important that the commitment's there,
yeah.
you know, and sometimes you don't have that. So, you know, something might get resolved before you get on, or it might have to continue because there have been people missing.
Right.
So, you know.
And that was another reason, you know, that this board was appealing to me when I was trying to weigh out, was that, of course, as most meetings do take place in the evening, I, being able to create so much of my own schedule, I know that I'll be able to say, okay, Tuesdays a month, make sure
right.
you're free, don't book anything there,
yeah, right.
be there. I mean,
correct.
Right now I can definitely get on my laptop.
Yeah,
I'll
right.
make sure when it's
right.
back to in
second,
person.
Second, fourth Tuesday of the month.
I already have it in.
Well, we want to thank you for coming on. It's
thank
been a pleasure speaking
me.
To you. We wish you a lot of luck.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hi everybody, it's Pattie with Get Personal with Pattie, and we are talking now to Gary Souza, former police chief. Gary Souza is joining us. He is asking for a seat on the Housing Authority,
Fairhaven Housing Authority. So he is going to tell us a little bit about what the Housing Authority does, introduce himself, kind of tell you what, you know, why he's here and why he's running for this position, and then we'll go into the questions that the public has asked.
Sure. I am running for Housing Authority in Fairhaven. The Housing Authority itself is the body that sets policy for the Housing Authority, and of course, including its residents, approves the budget process, and generally is the guiding body for the Housing Authority, awards contracts, but the one thing they do not do is get involved in the day-to-day running of the Housing Authority in order to keep politics out of it. The Housing Authority's day-to-day is managed by Mrs. Sheedy, the executive director. And I have some spare time, and I'd like to help serve the town.
That's great. How many people are on the Fairhaven Housing Authority board?
There would be five.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
And once every 5 years, they come up. Each one comes up for a re-election.
So it's a five-year position. Okay,
right.
Great. Certainly, I didn't know much about the Housing Authority, so yes, thank you. Thank you for that. So we do have three questions that came in from the public. So, you kind of semi-answered this one already. It was, why do you wish to be a commissioner on the Fairhaven Housing Authority?
Well, I can get a little further into that.
Yeah, sure, please.
I've been a Fairhaven resident for the last 45 years, been active in the town as a town meeting member, as police chief. I knew there was going to be a vacancy on the Housing Authority. I'm, as is pretty obvious to everyone, I'm a senior citizen myself. And
not obvious. You don't look a day over 50.
Oh, God, thank you. I love you, Pattie. This is a great show.
Thank you.
Obviously, I'm concerned with other seniors. When I was police chief, I saw, and my years as a police officer, sergeant, detective, I did see that the seniors in town, as in the rest of the Commonwealth, often have a hard time with it, making ends meet is what I mean, particularly ones who are only on Social Security, particularly people who've lost their spouses, particularly the disabled. It's really not a whole lot of money to get by on, and yet they still deserve a safe, comfortable, and clean place to live. So I've always been sympathetic to the seniors, and now I'm one of them.
Great. Thank you.
Gary, what initiatives do you prepare to improve for the properties?
Well, I think currently, as for a medium-sized housing authority that has 279 units plus three family units, the 279 are for seniors and the disabled, I think is just to continue to support the good work they're doing. Make sure contracts are awarded not only fairly, which I think they are, but to oversee that process, to be there for, to bring complaints or suggestions from residents to the executive director, and be an ear for the people who live in these elderly housing, subsidized housing. I have a pension myself. I can't imagine that I would ever meet the income guidelines, so I'm not interested in building up something for myself or my family. I have no dog in that race. I can look at the things unbiased and with no reason other than to do that.
Great, thank you. And so how would you support the staff, residents, visitors, and guests to be successful in providing decent housing to our seniors and families?
Well, that's a really multifaceted question. Mm-hmm. I'm the Housing Authority, the commissioners actually are precluded from, like I said, the day-to-day aspects of the and running of the facilities. I'm certainly not going to be going knocking on doors at these residents and interfering with Ms. Sheedy's management, but I will be available to meet with them or groups at any time they want to do that. I've got a lot of experience as a law enforcement officer, so one of my priorities would be to make sure they're in a safe area, that there's no reason that anybody on housing authority property shouldn't be able to, other residents shouldn't be able to go out at night and sit on the benches in the nice weather and not have to worry about crime. And I think from my experience, again, I've seen that generally there isn't very much of a problem on housing authority properties, particularly from people coming from the outside. So my priority would be to keep them safe, keep them clean, keep them comfortable, and to make sure that the periodic maintenance, I mean, little things like the people's tubs are caulked every few years, the locks are checked, those types of things are done, because it's the small things that make a difference in people's lives.
Right. What properties in Fairhaven are done by the Housing Authority? It
sure.
says McGann Terrace.
McGann Terrace, which is actually known as Green Meadows,
okay.
but I've always called it McGann Terrace, like you.
Yeah, exactly.
There's Anthony Haven on Main Street.
Okay, yeah.
There's Oxford Terrace, which is also on Main Street.
Okay, yeah.
There's Dana Farms, which is on Adams Street.
Okay.
And there are a few family units on Ash Street. The Fairhaven Village is not part of the Housing Authority. That's run privately by Peabody Properties, at least it was Peabody
okay,
Properties,
yeah,
I believe
yeah.
it still is. Mm-hmm. But that's low income and disabled, but it's not under the Housing Authority.
And the Oxford School is not going to be run by a
no.
Fairhaven, right? That's going to be private as well.
That's also private, yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Although they will have some subsidized housing
yeah.
there that, to the best of my knowledge, many of them will be market rate.
Okay. Well, what's market rate these days?
Yeah.
Right?
Not cheap.
I know. Some people's market rate is, so like you said, with the seniors, not, you know, geez, even 10 years ago was better. I don't know how seniors are doing it, really.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
market rate for rents are like a small mortgage.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Oh, that's terrible.
And I hate to contradict you, it's kind of getting like a medium-sized mortgage now. You're
yeah,
right.
Yeah, right, right, right,
yeah,
exactly.
I can agree with that. Yeah, I've
right.
definitely seen rent prices at about $1,800.
Yes,
and
yes.
Yeah.
That's averaging some people's mortgages these
Imagine
days.
Imagine that, $1,800.
Especially
for
on a fixed
yeah.
income.
I mean, I pay in the low thousand, very low thousand. So I'm happy with that
I
in
know.
My mortgage.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember my first house was $1,500 a mortgage.
Yeah.
That was 10 years ago.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
you know, if that's what the rents are now for a small one bedroom, I really don't know how people,
yeah.
you know, single parents do it, or seniors, because they're not, they're
Absolutely.
They're not getting any more money in their paycheck.
No, not from Social Security.
No.
Any raises are minuscule.
Right, absolutely.
Yeah. And, so that's why I think having a housing authority in, there are some towns that have housing authorities, but no housing, small towns.
Right,
and,
right.
But. The I'm glad Fairhaven stepped up a long time ago and decided to do that. I mean, there are different priorities for housing. Emergencies come first, obviously,
mm-hmm.
and then there's veterans and veteran spouses. But there's also income requirement. You can't just be a veteran and making
right.
I don't know, $100,000
yeah,
a year and
right.
move in there. I mean, it's got to
mm-hmm.
be for people who need it, who deserve
right.
it.
Right.
So there's a whole lot of criteria. I like the fact that the commissioners themselves are absolutely precluded from using any of their influence or even interfering at all in tenant selection.
Right.
That really keeps it above board and fair, and I'm very glad the state made it that way.
Great. Well, I think you've answered a lot of our questions and the public's questions, and I learned more about the Fairhaven Housing Authority.
Same.
Right, I really didn't know a lot, so I appreciate you coming on and talking to us. It was nice, and we wish you the best of luck. You are running unopposed.
Yeah.
But, so that means congratulations is in order. You have, you know, one vote, maybe two more.
thank you very much.
All
it's
right.
been happy. I'm happy to be here, and it's nice meeting you ladies.
Yes,
you
nice
well.
Meeting
Thank
as well.
You.
And don't forget, April 4th, that's Monday, and election polls are open at 10 a.m. Thank you.